Well, it's certainly to do the second, to create a new infrastructure and architecture for the international part of the financial markets. We need the equivalent of an international bank regulator. We need the equivalent of an international central bank. And we need some entity that can prevent the kinds of imbalances and the huge flows of hot money in and out of countries that have been causing problems really since the 80s, Charlie, with the Latin American debt crisis, and then you had the Asian financial crisis, then you had the internet bubble, now you have this. They're all versions of the same thing, and this boom and bust is not only not healthy. People don't like it. It might, in the long run, generate more efficiency in the world and even more growth, but people value stability. Human beings do, and they don't like these kinds of swings.
Does the IMF sort of fit the model, or could it be the institution that becomes the model for what they might do?
Sure. I mean, you know, you start with something. You might as well, why create a whole new institution? Its governance has to change. It has to have a lot more money, and it has to be given a lot more power. And this is the key issue. Do sovereign countries want to give up some of their economic policy-making powers to an international body that they don't control? The answer is no, they don't want to. But if they don't, they're going to continue to be subject to these kinds of swings. And that's the trade-off. And it's a very difficult political trade-off for countries to make. Usually it requires a war, like World War II, or a depression, like the Great Depression, to finally force them into it. And we'll see whether this is enough of a crisis that really tips the balance this time.